Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves, continuing medical education podcast. Join us for a lively discussion on the latest and greatest in the field of electrocardiography. We'll discuss some of the exciting and innovative work happening at Mayo Clinic and beyond with the most brilliant minds in the space and provide valuable insights that can be directly applied to your practice. Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves. In this episode, we explore the rapidly evolving field of atrial fibrillation therapy, focusing on pulse field ablation, or PFA, a modality that has transformed the landscape of atrial fibrillation catheter ablation. Joining us is an expert and cardiac electrophysiologist, here to provide insights into how pulse field ablation differs from traditional thermal-based techniques, its recurrence rates, and the most common causes of redo procedures. We'll also discuss how pulse field ablation may evolve in the coming years to improve durability and outcomes. But first, let me introduce you to our guest today. Dr. Nicholas Tan completed his undergraduate degree in biomedical engineering at Johns Hopkins University, following which he completed medical school and a master's degree in biomedical investigation from the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine. He then did his internal medicine, cardiovascular medicine, and cardiac electrophysiology training here at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester. In July of 2023, he was hired on staff within the Division of Heart Rhythm Services. His research interests include developing device-based therapies for pacing, defibrillation, and cardiac ablations, as well as electrophysiology considerations in cancer patients. Additionally, he is completing a master's degree in medical device innovation from the University of Minnesota. Dr. Tan, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks a lot for having me.
You know, well, you know, PFA or pulse field ablation is really changing the landscape. But before we get into it, just to get our audience on the same page, let's kind of go to the basics. What exactly is pulse field ablation and how is it different from the more established methods like radiofrequency or cryoablation?
That's a great question. So, just to go back even further a little bit, cardiac ablation first started with DC shocks, so direct current energy that was applied to the tip of a catheter to induce myocardial ablation. Now, obviously, that was a little traumatic when it first occurred in 1980 or so. And so radiofrequency ablation developed from there, where you basically deliver heat energy to the tip of a catheter to ablate tissue. Cryoablation is sort of on the opposite end of the spectrum, where you're cooling tissue to the point where you cause myocardial death. Now, both these modalities have something in common in that heat transfer always occurs, and heat will always move in other directions and usually in directions that you don't want. So you can cause collateral damage to the coronary arteries, to nerves, to the esophagus. And those are complications that we really try to shy away from. Now, pulse field ablation is different in that instead of delivering a long pulse of electricity, you're delivering multiple short pulses to your target tissue. And it turns out that cardiomyocytes tend to be much more sensitive to its effects biologically compared to most other tissue types. And so what happens then is that you can induce myocardial death either through necrosis or through apoptosis without causing any heat transfer. And this has led to the development of these PFA-based catheters where you can effectively kill myocardial tissue without injuring any of the neighboring structures. So because of that, it has significantly transformed the way that we have practiced. PFA was clinically used in Europe, or has been used in Europe for the past few years, and we recently had it FDA approved, and it's really transformed our practice in many ways.
It seems like this is, you know, already, as you mentioned, transforming practices. In terms of your practice and, you know, what you've seen across colleagues, how do you see how this has changed in terms of recurrence rates for someone with atrial fibrillation, if they come and, you know, are having a PVI with this method versus prior techniques? Yeah. Are we seeing better outcomes? Are the challenges similar to what you described previously with, you know, the heat exchange?
in terms of recurrence rates, that's something in the US at least, that's something that we are starting to learn about, because for the most part, most centers started using PFA only last year after it was FDA approved. And so this year is when we start seeing the one-year recurrences. But based on prior trial data and based on data from Europe, what we have ascertained is that the recurrence rates following PFA is fairly comparable to the other previous modalities. And this is, and keep in mind that this is a relatively new technology. This is including operators who may not be necessarily as experienced with PFA compared to other the other established modalities. And despite that, recurrence rates tend to be similar. And so generally speaking, the numbers that have kind of shaken out across these studies and trials is about 30% over a one-year course. And again, that is very, very comparable to what we see with RF or cryoablation.
And so 30% recurrence after a year, similar to other modalities and ablation techniques, yet probably minimizing the risk of more serious injuries, maybe the esophageal, complications or things along that.
That is correct.
In terms of, redo after this index pulse field ablation, are you seeing also similar reasons for why there might be recurrence?
For the most part, that certainly seems to be the case. Again, we need more data from the U.S. side to see if there are any significant differences between that and this other studies that are performed elsewhere. But for the most part, the recurrences, about two-thirds of them would tend to occur in the pulmonary veins. So again, the main goal of AFib catheter ablation is to target the pulmonary veins, hence the name pulmonary vein isolation, or PVI. So it turns out that in the patients that you do bring back to the lab for redo procedure after an initial PFA ablation, the pulmonary veins are the most common sources of these recurrences. And so that may be due to incomplete ablation with the initial ablation procedure or some healing that occurs subsequently. It may have to do with the differences in terms of how we ascertain whether we cause reversible versus irreversible damage to the muscle. That is a nuance that we are starting to understand a little bit more. And then in the other one-third of cases, you have other areas that can serve as triggers for AFib. And again, those will require de novo ablation, such as the posterior wall. Sometimes you can have flutters that occur as well. And those will need to be assessed and dealt with accordingly.
And so now that we're learning more, as you mentioned, about a year into this, starting to collect some of this recurrence data and understanding more, maybe similar recurrence rates, where do you see the field going over the next few years? Do you see kind of new tools and protocols as you better understand the underlying, process of what's going on? Or what are your thoughts?
This podcast is actually timely in that we very recently acquired a novel catheter system from Medtronic. So it's called the Affera system. It's a mapping and ablation catheter that can perform both RF ablation and PFA. So how this can be helpful is that there are certain areas that are probably still better for RF ablation, such as flutter lines. One main issue that we see with PFA in areas where the coronary arteries are close by is that you can actually cause the coronary arteries to spasm, and you don't normally get that effect with RFA. So having a catheter that can toggle between PFA and RFA is very helpful in this regard. And that's for atrial ablations. So we are also starting to look into ventricular ablations for PFA, using PFA. And again, two new tools are being developed to try and tackle that problem. And again, that's a totally different beast, because when you think about the atrial tissue, it's relatively thin. Ventricular tissue can be much thicker is more complex. So that will be another growing arena of research, and that you know is kind of ripe for the taking at this point.
Wonderful. Wow. Well, it's an exciting field, a lot of development. And, you know, Dr. Tan, thank you so much for joining us and sharing about the innovation in PFA, pulse field ablation, and its impact on atrial fibrillation therapy. Dr. Tan provided valuable insights on how pulse field ablation differs from traditional ablation techniques, the challenges of recurrence rates, and we're still learning a lot about that about a year into this. That's similar. And the most common causes of redo is still another area that we're trying to understand. He also shared the vision, you know, of the future of pulse field ablation, these new tools that are helping us map and understand it. And the ventricular arrhythmias are another beast, as he mentioned. Dr. Tan, thank you so much for sharing your expertise and providing a clear and thoughtful overview of this transformative technology. We look forward to having you back in the future to discuss further developments in the field. Thank you again.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you for joining us today. We invite you to share your thoughts and suggestions about the podcast at cveducation.mayo.edu. Be sure to subscribe to a Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular CME podcast on your favorite platform. And tune in every other week to explore today's most pressing electrocardiography topics with your colleagues at Mayo Clinic.
This has been a Mayo Clinic podcast.